I'm Paul Costello, the Executive Director of the Vermont Council on Rural Development. Welcome to the Catalysts of the Climate Economy Summit. To our guests from all across the country, welcome to Vermont. To our regional friends, to Vermonters, welcome to UVM, your school. And to everyone here, welcome home. This is home base. We're dedicated to attracting, nurturing, and inspiring the people, the catalysts, who construct economic solutions to climate change and who are building a model of economic renewal for the nation one day at a time. All of you gathered here are our catalysts for the climate economy. This is about you. The builders of our collective future, creators, community leaders, investors, innovative businesses, committed young people. You're our heroes and heroines for the next 3 days. Let's not underestimate our collective power and our influence. In these daunting times, America needs a new narrative of success and a new definition of progress. We're creating it right here, step by step. And we will be victorious. So logistics here tonight. We're going to have book sales up here after the event with Bear Pond Books from Montpelier. Great to have them with us after Paul Hawken's speech. Then, after this event is over, people who are signed up for the conference will head up to the tent outside Dudley Davis. You'll see signs for it. We'll have an opening celebration with Kat Wright and the Indomitable Blues Band, food trucks, Vermont's finest, especially some of the world's finest brews and so forth. Help us toast the future. It's my pleasure to introduce Joe Fusco from Casella's in Vermont. Joe's the chairman of the Climate Economy Action Team that we work with as we advance this effort in Vermont. Joe's a person of tremendous vision. While we look at our engineering and we look at our weeds, Joe turns it to poetry and shares the big picture of where we're going. So it's my honor to introduce Joe Fusco to introduce Paul Hawken.
We've been having a conversation for several years in Vermont around the idea of whether entrepreneurialism and environmentalism belong together. Do they belong together in the same sentence? Do they belong together in the same breath? Do they belong together in the same time and place? Rather than just looking at climate change as being a scenario of doom and gloom, rather than looking at it as just one of civilization's greatest challenges, it's important also to look at it as one of the greatest business and economic development opportunities in a generation. Somewhere, somehow, somebody is going to solve this problem. Someone, somewhere, is going to reinvent and innovate around clean, renewable energy. Somewhere, someone is going to disrupt the way we move around our homes and our jobs, the way we transport our goods and services. Somewhere, someone is going to disrupt the way we live in our homes and work in our businesses. Someone is going to solve this problem. The conversation in Vermont for us, and it's now a national conversation as well as we welcome partners from around the country, the conversation in Vermont is, can Vermont become the kind of place where these problems are solved? Can we become a spectacularly attractive place to start and grow a business to solve the problems around climate change and resource renewal? We believe that we can, and we're eager and grateful that you've come here, whether you're from Vermont or around the nation, to come have that conversation about whether this and every other place in the United States can be the home where environmentalism and entrepreneurialism exist side by side, in the same breath, in the same sentence, in the same time and place. I had the pleasure of meeting our keynote speaker about 45 minutes ago. And he said to me, he said, "Joe, say whatever you want," which, if you think about it, really means that very little needs to be said at all. If you're here, you know who Paul Hawken is. You're familiar with his ethic, you're familiar with his work, you're familiar with his thinking. You've read books of his, whether it's books about natural capitalism or the ecology of commerce or how to grow a business. You've seen it in his life's work, in the businesses that he started, in the projects and ideas that he has been the catalyzing driver behind. So we're very lucky to have him here because this conversation is about what this man's life and career has been about. Because in this man's life and career, you have seen entrepreneurialism and environmentalism exist in the same breath, in the same sentence, in the same time and place. Please join me in giving a warm Vermont welcome to our keynote speaker this evening, Mr. Paul Hawken.
I feel so welcome here, I just want to move here every time I come here. It is so great to be back in Vermont. Thank you so much. Thank you, Paul, for your work and the council itself and what it's doing, what it stands for. Thank you, Chuck, for being here. Everybody knows, does everybody know Chuck? Great. What was it, Secretary of Agriculture in Vermont, you know, and I have so many friends here, if I start naming them, I'm going to forget someone, so I beg your pardon. But I do want to acknowledge the Alec and Webb and Megan Camp and Marshall Webb from Shelburne Farms, who've done just an extraordinary job in building sustainability both on the farm and in the curriculum in Vermont schools. And can you hear me in the back? No, that's what I was afraid of. Can you guys turn the volume up? Because we could barely hear him up here when Paul was speaking. Is this better? Yeah, thank you. Good. All that good. And thank you for being here tonight. I have my clicker here, and there we go, drawdown. It's what I came here to speak about. And drawdown, just in the context of climate, means that first time on a year-to-year basis where greenhouse gases peak and go down on a year-to-year basis. So. And I'll get back to that as to why we named Project Drawdown Project Drawdown. It seems obvious maybe to you, but there's actually more to it. For me, and this doesn't have much sound, it does actually, I don't know if you want to turn up the sound, you can. This is Greenland in the summer. This is a North Eemian Ice Research Station in 2009, and I went there on a fact-finding mission as a journalist. And what they did there, they accomplished it eventually, was to drill down through the ice sheet to bedrock. And you go in there, this is the ice cave, it's really the only warm place, truly. And it's when we were there, it was 30 below in summer. Scientists from 14 countries, and basically you can see the drill, it goes way down. The lubrication they use for the ice cores are coconut oil. It's so interesting. So when it comes back up, it's white and steaming and bubbling, and it looks like, I don't know, it looks like from a bad science fiction B movie, you know, like it came from the deep. But anyway, they bring these cores up, and this is what they look like. And with that, they can compare notes with Antarctica, who are doing the same drilling, and tell exactly pretty much where we were in a given time in terms of pollen counts, sulfates, CO2 to be sure, temperatures, etc. And this is important to me because what they were studying is the Eemian period. And if you look at this graph, what you're seeing is CO2 levels for the last 400,000 years. And you see a line there which is 300 ppm. You can extend that line back for 2 million years, and no species of Homo, Homo erectus, Homo sapiens, Homo whatever, has ever existed on this planet over 300 ppm until 1935. So the idea that we know what it's going to be like for us over 300 ppm is speculative. It may be great science, but we do not know. But what you see here is the current level of CO2. It's 407, but it's not. This is actually what it is today. It's 490 ppm, because you have to put in the other greenhouse gases in their CO2 equivalents. And that's methane, and that's obviously nitrous oxide, why am I blanking on the other one? Don't tell me. And hydrofluorocarbons, right? HFCs, yeah. So it's 490 ppm, and that peak you see on your right, not the peak to 490, but that peak is the Eemian period. And that was 125,000 years ago. At that time, the temperature on Earth was 1 to 2 C higher than it was 150 years ago. And at 1 to 2 C higher, the oceans were 20 to 30 feet higher than they are today. There were hippopotamus lounging in the Thames River Delta. Sussex and Kent did not exist, really, underwater. And lions and giraffes were romping across Germany and Denmark, and crocodiles were making their way up into Alaska. And that's 1 to 2 C, okay, 2 Celsius. So to me, and this goes back to drawdown, what's happened, from my point of view, for a long time, is that the goals that have been stated around climate have been so unusual, let's say, just so weak. And what are the goals? Mitigation, stabilization, reduction. And if you can show me anywhere on that line above 300 ppm where you want to mitigate and stabilize, I'm happy to hear about it. Because there's no such thing as stabilization at any of those levels. And the UNFCCC, Article 2, states very clearly that the purpose of the UN Framework Conference on Climate Change is to mitigate CO2 levels at a level that is safe enough for worldwide food production. Do you know what mitigate means? It means to reduce the amount of suffering or damage or seriousness. It just means to lower the impact of something. That's what mitigate means. I think they meant militate, but I'm not sure. I didn't write that. But the point is, that is not a goal that makes sense. So for us at Project Radon, which I want to talk about, we wanted to name the goal. If we don't name the goal, how are we going to achieve it? This is not our goal. And stabilizing, whatever that means, that somewhere along this is not our goal either. And virtually everything that's been proposed by the leaders in the climate movement have basically been to achieve stabilization. No net new emissions. Well, it doesn't matter where you achieve that. You are at a very high level of CO2 in the atmosphere and CO2 equivalent greenhouse gases, and the weather is going to go crazy on us. So the only goal that makes sense is not reduce, but to reverse. And I think a lot of you understand this, whether it's in your artists, or your musicians, or you're in business, or you're in governance. When you expand the goal, it makes it easier. More innovation, more creativity, more spaciousness. Your minds open up when the goals are big. When the goals are narrow, it's not very stimulating. It doesn't really enchant. And so by expanding to drawdown, I think what we have shown is that basically this is much more interesting than just wind, solar, and Elon Musk, and don't eat so many hamburgers. And that's essentially the mantra for the last 20 years, basically. If we get that right, that somehow we get a hall pass to the 22nd century. And that is a scientific howler. We can do those things exactly as designed, go to net zero in terms of carbon energy with wind and solar, and eat less hamburgers, and drive Teslas, and we will go right over the cliff. only slowly. It'll be like Thelma and Louise in slow motion. That doesn't get us back to where we want to go. So that's drawdown. And this is how people get their information on climate change. It's fantastic science, the IPCC. The headlines are good science. But what they get it is in ways that threaten them, that invoke fear and gloom and doom and anxiety. And then next to it, you have this thing, wife smashes husband's head with frog ornament and kept him mummified in plastic sheeting for 18 years. In other words, you have clickbait next to basically the word of doom, right? And they're on they're equivalent. And you see this over and over. The headlines are based on good science, you know? And here, the 20 things you never knew you could do with Coca-Cola, you know? And above the headline about this chilling study, and basically they are doing the right thing with Coca-Cola, which is pouring it down the toilet, but so they got both that right, the Coca-Cola and the headline, but what do human beings do with headlines like that? You are literate about this subject, so this doesn't apply to you, but this most of the world is getting their climate literacy from this stuff. You know, and if you Google what are the top 10 solutions, or 100, or 50, you name it, solutions to climate change or global warming, this is the top two hits you will get on Google, and both from scientific organizations, and you know, forego fossil fuels, for sure, move closer to work, you know, consume less. These are proverbs; they're not solutions. They're like love your mother, you know. Yeah. It's hard, but I'm going to do it. And number three, you know, use power strips in your home entertainment center. Well, gosh, how many people have home entertainment centers? I mean, to put that out as a climate solution tells individuals, basically, that no matter what you do, it isn't adequate to the task and headlines you just saw, which is it ain't going to amount to a hill of beans. That's what you're saying to people. So how do people feel if they care? They feel guilty. Inside, they don't mind say it out, but they say a lot, but they feel guilty, like, I can't, wow, I'm not doing enough, or I can't do enough, or, you know? So you mix fear, anxiety, threat, doom with guilt and shame. Is anybody here a psychologist? Stir well, and what do you get? Numbness, denial, like I can't handle this, I got a mortgage, I have two kids in school. I mean, it's like too much, right? And what our narrative has been about the probabilities, the scientific probabilities of what's going to go wrong and when. Or it's getting worse faster than we thought. That's another good header now. Right? So what do you do with that news? Instead of about possibility. And to my way of thinking, the IPCC assessments, the six ones coming out, what, next year, the year after? The five so far are the best problem statement you could ever see. Extraordinary science. Every headline, like we saw there, is a validation of the problem statement. If you have such a great problem statement and you have the validation, then the only thing to focus on is to solve the problem. Not to push people's noses more into the problem, because it just doesn't work in terms of human creativity. What we want to know, what I wanted to know when I started this organization for a long time, where do we stand? The do is missing there. Where do we stand? Is it game over? Could be. Do we know? Why don't we know? After 40 years in the public sphere, why don't we know? Where do we stand? You know? And so, Project Drawdown, what do? Well, we do the math. That's what we do. And we knew that in order to figure out where we stood, what we wanted to do was to map, measure, and model the 100 most substantive solutions to reversing global warming. That was our self-imposed mandate. And to do that, once modeled, we wanted to project them out over 30 years. Every solution we modeled that's in the book, you see tonight, is in place. We know how to do it. It's W.W. Granger stuff. It is not pie in the sky, silver bullets, or if only we should, we could. No, it is what we are doing right now. And each one of these solutions is scaling. So what we did is we continued to scale them in a rigorous but reasonable way. And to see, could we achieve within 30 years the reversal of global warming, the reversal of carbon emissions, that we could begin to draw down greenhouse gases from the atmosphere instead of just stopping putting them up there. And to do that, we needed help. We knew that if a small NGO in Sausalito, California, came out with a study about the 100 most substantive solutions, we'd have all the credibility of a lentil. And and we had no money anyway. And so we went out around the world and asked scholars at leading universities to be drawdown research fellows. One of them is here tonight, Marilyn Waite, who is, that woman on the bottom, the sixth from the left with the beautiful fro, there she is in the back, from Cambridge and University of Princeton, and one of our drawdown fellows, senior fellows. This group came from 22 countries, six continents, 40% women. We didn't choose by gender. It was a meritocracy, but it just shows you how fast women are moving into science. The half PhDs, all advanced degrees, and they did the core research in drawdown. And this was the beginning of what is a collaboration. And we felt that what we wanted to do was to get together with a lot of people. This is some of our 128 advisors. There's names here you recognize. Bill McKibben's here, but not here, but he's here in Vermont, in Middlebury. Michael Mann, you hear about all the time, some you don't know about. But basically, there's IPCC lead authors, there's scientists, botanists, engineers, architects, politicians, religious leaders, authors, writers. A very, very diverse but important group of people who gave us advice on content. And on top of that, we had 40 outside scientific expert reviewers to review our models. So it was a collaboration. And what it is a small we, and what we did is we took all our information from, we did the math, and we did this, okay? So here's the solution, geothermal. And the first thing you see is rank. That rank is by the amount of CO2 or CO2 equivalent gases that can be avoided or sequestered, depending on the solution, by 2050 if it continues to scale using the assumptive input we put in terms of the rate of scaling, which is based on what is happening already. And next to that is the gigaton, the billion metric ton equivalent, of CO2 gas equivalents. And this is entirely based on peer-reviewed science. So we didn't, no data on carbon is from us. In fact, no data in this whole thing is from us. It's all from the rest of the world. And so this is peer-reviewed. The economic numbers, net costs and net savings, are from respected international institutions, the IEA, the World Bank, WHO, FAO, EASA, ARENA, you name it. These are respected international institutions. And so essentially what Project Drawdown was and is us taking this data and information from the world and putting it together and reflecting back to the world what we know. It's not what we know in Sausalito. It's what you know, which is your we, right? It's what we know collectively. So this isn't pie in the sky. This isn't a proposal. This isn't, hey, follow us. This is saying, basically, humanity is on the case. And we are showing humanity what it knows and what it is doing. So on the numbers, those are compared to basically business as usual. So if you didn't do geothermal where it's applicable, what would you do? Combined cycle gas or coal? So we compared the relative costs. And we did the same in terms of net savings. So the net savings would be $1.0 trillion in 30 years. And so now I'm just going to show you a bunch of solutions. And I think the important thing to see here is the diversity of solutions that arose. And our process was we started with 300 and kept winnowing them down and down and down until we got to 80. that we actually model and measured and they're in the book. And again, afforestation, there's two types of afforestation, which we talk about. This is high-speed rail. The Japanese pretty much own this, along with the Chinese now. This is indigenous people's land management. And nobody manages land better than indigenous people. Indigene, the noun, means the original inhabitant. So in other words, the original human inhabitants of that land, at least as far as we know, are the ones who know what to do with that land and take care of it the best. It's just, and it's demonstrably true. This is the Caiapó in Brazil. This is improved rice production. There's two ways to change rice production so it doesn't produce so much methane, and you actually increase productivity. Your costs go down, so you see no net cost, but you do see net savings in terms of higher productivity. This is onshore wind. This is not a ridge top. This is down the ground. This is the number two solution in terms of impact. 7.43 trillion net savings. What we want to do with the imagery, and you see it here, is to break the mindset about imagery. The idea of, you see these images of like a wind turbine on this green grassy hill with children playing at the base and wildflowers and the sky's blue and there's this wind turbine. You go, oh God, that's so great. That's a terrible place for a wind turbine. This is a good place for a wind turbine where the weather's really pissy and awful. And this is Norfolk, Sheringham Shoal in the North Sea. And these are Siemens 3 megawatt wind turbines that are really kick it up. High capacity factor. This is offshore wind. This is an Ura woman in Lake Titicaca who lives on a straw island with her two daughters. She has to put straw down every 90 days in order for the island not to sink. And she was using kerosene. Kerosene on a straw island to light up her home at night so her daughters could study. So solar doesn't mean like what we think of solar, like a substitution. For her, yes, it did substitute for kerosene. For her, it's safety, it's kindness, it's being a good mom. And really, all of these solutions have so many other benefits than just their carbon or climate impact. This is net zero buildings, very low ranking, because everything that makes a net zero building is somewhere else in the solutions. It's not that it would rank very high, but we didn't double count, so we don't want to double count. This is the Great Bear Forest. This is the Kermode Bear. This is really about forest protection, 896.2 gigatons of CO2 protected, almost exactly what's up in the atmosphere, by the way. This is cool cook stoves. Again, the benefits to the mothers, to the children, extraordinary. Black carbon is not a greenhouse gas, but it is definitely a greenhouse substance, particle. It has a very big impact in India and other places where there's a lot of people using cook stoves otherwise. This man is waving, he's in Montreal, just so you know. He's waving, he actually works for PricewaterhouseCoopers, the former accounting firm of the Oscars. Probably bye. But he's waving to Ivan in Prague. And what Ivan can do at PwC in Prague is just log on to an iPad on a kind of modified sort of semi-Segway scooter and scoot around the office and go to your office and show up at a meeting, could come right in the room right now, come up to the microphone, ask a question, whatever. And this is a transport solution we call telepresence. And the idea is let's ship more ideas around than protoplasm. Be a good idea. This surprised us. What does it look like to you? It's reduced food waste. All this food is being thrown away. Unbelievably. Why? Well, shape, size, color, mar, bruise, whatever. All this stuff is being thrown away. And this is one packing house. over 40% of the food in the United States is wasted, okay? Over 30% in the world, some say nearly 40, for different reasons. Here it's wasted at home and stores and cold and restaurants, the rest of the world and farms and cold chains and so forth. This also exemplifies something we want to inform or to make clear, which is that every single solution here was based on the most conservative numbers. We didn't want anybody to do a gotcha and say, oh, you know. It was without bias, objectively, always doing sensitivity analysis on median numbers. And in this case, we did not count methane emissions from food that's landfilled, which are huge, huge. And if we did that, it would be much higher than the number three solution. This one is a, see if you can guess what solution this is. What? Huh? Yeah, it is reuse, exactly. It's household recycling, but it's reuse. Exactly, it's a Dasanak woman in Ethiopia, and they built a bridge across from their village, and the women go across the bridge, or the unbuilt bridge, but the building bridge, where they built a bar for the men building the bridge, and they would pick up all the things the men were throwing away, including SIM cards and beer bottle caps and anything else they could find, and make headdresses and jewelry out of it. And now they sell it to boutiques in France. So smart women. And this is a plant-rich diet, number four solution, which actually is reducing the amount of protein in the developed countries, or where men and women are eating 100, 110 grams, which is not good for your body. Increasing it in those countries where there's nutrient deficiency as well as caloric intake to 2,500 calories. And then a substitution for plant protein, for some animal protein, but this is not a vegan or vegetarian diet unless you choose to. And even then, it's the number four solution. And then what we did, and I won't go over these too much, is we did 20 coming attractions. And these are solutions that are scientifically validated, but there isn't enough information to actually model it, both economically and in terms of carbon. And this was created by Dr. Brian Van Herzen, a plasma physicist who was flying over Greenland at the behest of a friend in his Cessna 337, who asked him to do the count of the melt ponds in 2001. In Greenland, and he did, and a couple years later he said, you know, those aren't ponds anymore, they're more like lakes. And then he himself was so struck 2 years later when he saw that it was one massive, massive lake, and he knew, he just got this sense of how fast Greenland ice sheet was melting. It was extraordinary to see that rise in temperature in such a short time from the air. And so he devoted his life to basically restoring living systems. And this goes to something I want to say about narrative. The narrative from the climate establishment has been about we're burning too many fossil fuels and we got to stop that stuff, stop that, you know, and basically go to clean, renewable energy. And there's a few other things we can do and stop cutting trees. And it's been we've screwed up by burning coal, gas, and oil. Well, that's true in that sense. But really, the proper narrative is that we've screwed up all the cycles on Earth. The water cycle, the nitrogen cycle, definitely the carbon cycle, but not just the carbon cycle in coal, gas, and oil, in our soils, right? So it's all the cycles that have changed. So those cycles are actually our pathways and our teaching and our guides to go back to reverse global warming. And this is one of them. 99% of marine oceans in tropical areas are deserts. They're complete deserts. There's no life there whatsoever. He makes these frames out of recycled PET, sinks them low enough so boats going over, freighters going over them won't disturb it. And then he has these tubes that he designed that go down to the thermocline, to the cold nutrient-laden waters, could be 200 feet, 300 feet down. And then they're self-actuating by the rise and fall of the water, and they bring up this cold water. Within 3-4 weeks, you get this cascade. You get phytoplankton, zooplankton, you get algae, you get kelp, you get feeder fish, forage fish, you get whale sharks. You saw one whale shark after like 4 or 5 weeks in Hawaii. It's amazing how fast the ocean will regenerate itself. And what we've done is 93%, 94%, 95% of all the heat that is being absorbed by the earth is being absorbed by the oceans, not by land. And so it is producing heat blankets, which are stopping the natural thermoclines and natural circulation patterns in the oceans to arise. And so he's bringing it back in a sense, a localized way. And his estimates are that we could produce 10 billion pounds of protein a year if we put these on coral reefs and where fisheries are and aren't. And what's interesting is because kelp sequesters carbon faster than any other plant, land or water, it basically deacidifies the water there, and of course it cools it at the same time. So you can go back to some of the bleaching coral reefs and sort of regenerate them too and restart and reseed coral life on those reefs using this. And this one is similarly biological. Repopulating the mammoth steppe. There's a big article in Atlantic Monthly you might have seen a couple months ago about two biologists, Sergey and Nikita Zimov. Sergey's been walking the mammoth steppe, which is a subarctic area of Russia, and basically came to a different conclusion than paleontologists and so forth, which is that the animals that used to be there were extirpated by the Clovis people. They didn't die because of cold. And that if you bring the animals back, the muskox and the reindeer and the Yakutian horses and the other strange species, you can't bring back the woolly mammoth, but maybe, but bring them back, what happens is in the winter, in the dark, they have to eat and they push away the snow to get to the dead browse. And that cools the soil temperature by 2 degrees centigrade. So this is a permafrost protection plan by repopulating the mammoth steppe right away, Alaska, Canada, all the way across Russia. And of course, it's beautiful, as so many of these things are, including this one, which is building with wood. I don't know if anybody's here from Yale, but save me if you are. Whenever I say this, people don't believe it. This is safer than a steel and concrete building and a fire. I go, no, Paul. Read the book, read the Yale study. The Grenfell fire wouldn't have happened in this kind of structure. The Torch Tower in Dubai wouldn't have happened with this kind of structure. Wood in this form doesn't burn. It's big beams, chars, but it doesn't burn. It doesn't get very hot. It doesn't melt steel. It doesn't collapse buildings. It doesn't produce gases, et cetera, et cetera. But this has at least, according to the Yale studies, a potential reducing greenhouse gases by 14% per year. 50,000 skyscrapers are going to be built in China in the next 30 years of steel and concrete. And this last one, a cow walks onto a beach, is started in Prince Edward Island. A farmer, dairy farmer, noticed that the cows in his herd, they were eating kelp, were producing more milk. And the question was, why? And so he asked the county agent, he said, I don't know, and said, you have to talk to a scientist. And the scientist said the only plausible reason is they're not producing as much methane. Methane is a very inefficient metabolic process, and ruminants didn't start out producing methane, by the way. Whatever that opportunistic bacteria that got in there that breaks down cellulose and for lunch, breakfast, and dinner is there in cows and sheep and goats, but it's not innate. It is now, but it wasn't always. And so what they did is they split the herd, fed some kelp, and put plastic bags on their head 5 times a day, measured the exhalations, and sure enough, they reduced methane and more milk. But it was a science experiment which had no meaning, since very few people can feed their cows kelp. And so he then met, heard of a scientist in Queensland who was doing the same research, And they identified an algae called Asparagopsis taxiformis, which the native Hawaiians have been eating for thousands of years, maybe not thousands, but over 1,000 years, in their cuisine, that if fed in a 2% quantity to ruminants, reduces methane emissions by 70 to 90%. And that we know the mechanism, it's just that it's never been practical until they discovered Asparagopsis taxiformis. That guy is talking to this guy, and they're forming a company to grow Asparagopsis taxiformis. But the thing about coming attractions is that on one hand, we're measuring the 80 solutions that are in place that we know how to do and that are scaling. There's no question about them at all. But it's important for people to understand that we are not just stopped there. That's not where humanity is going to rest on its so-called laurels. I mean, humanity is really on the case, and the imagination and the creativity and the innovation that's happening right now is extraordinary. We have another book coming out with 60 to 80 more of these coming attractions, and they're just as fascinating and as ingenious as these. What surprised us? Everything. We did not see the top five, the top 10. If you had asked me to guess what they are, write them down, a year ago, 6 months ago, 2-3 years ago, I would have got them pretty much all wrong. What's going on? There we go. Well, surprise, we didn't know. All right. Okay, here's the food is 8 of the top 20. Again, there's some great food people here. This is a great food state. Who knew? Who said? Nothing, right? Do we know that? I mean, if you look at a tree map, one person did right here. Okay, he raises it. Thank you. Anybody else want to raise their hand? 8 of the top 20. I mean, it's extraordinary. And electricity generation is a smaller sector than food. Why? Because food does two things. It emits greenhouse gases, but when you change practices, it sequesters carbon. It's a twofer. It does both. Very few things can do that, that stop emitting and bring it down as well. And food and land use are those things. Materials is top solution. Refrigeration, refrigerant management, HFCs. We were so disappointed when this turned out to be true. We want something sexy and photogenic, and there it was. And this, again, is conservative. It doesn't include the Kigali Amendment to the Montreal Protocol that was passed last September, I think, in Rwanda, that would basically phase out HFCs by 2030. Electricity generation is 5 of the top 20. If you combine off and onshore wind, it becomes the number one solution. Solar, as you can see, is not number one or two. Listen, we just do the math. So if you're in the solar industry, it's fine. You have plenty of business to do. But I'm just saying, this wasn't our idea. We don't advocate here. We illustrate. There's a difference, you know. This is data you can count on and depend on, and it's transparent. This surprised us, and this is educating girls. And it was a number six solution. There are at least 996 reasons to make sure every girl in the world is educated. On top of that, it is a pathway to family planning, which is coming from the girl, now woman, herself. If you take a girl out of school at puberty or pre-puberty, which is happening around the world because of family, custom, religion, culture, she then is becoming a woman on other people's terms. She's put to work to put her brothers through school. She is married off, early marriage. She has on average 5+ children. Those children are in poverty. They don't have the same educational opportunities as a girl who went because of her poverty, et cetera. It's a devolving cycle of poverty and lack of education and poor health. If she's allowed to matriculate to 11th, 12th grade, what we call high school, She becomes a woman more or less, but more on her terms instead of somebody else's. And she makes very different choices. She has better education. She earns more. She puts those resources into 2+ children, not 5+, who replicate her behavior, boys or girls, when they marry and when they have children. So it's a pathway to family planning. This is family planning, the number 7 solution, which basically is clinics everywhere in the world to support women's reproductive health and well-being and family choice. And we mean everywhere, not Africa, we mean Arkansas, we mean the whole world. The idea that somehow they should have family planning? No, every woman should have access to it, and they do not. But together, it's 119.2 gigatons. It's based on the UN median to high population figures in 2050. It's not our data, again. This is the UN. And this is the difference between the availability and the application of family planning in the world and its lack. And so together, though, you put 6 and 7 together and add them up, then the empowerment of girls and women is the number one solution to reversing global warming. And again, this doesn't obviate the need for solar or for renewable clean energy or for EVs, not at all. It's just that the narrative has been so skewed around energy, and it's understandable because 60 to 70% of the CO2 up there since the industrial age, the additional CO2 is from combustion of fossil fuels. So we got that, we understand that. But the pathway back is not the same as the pathway in. It's very, very different. And this is what the solutions look like on a pie chart. And the thing I want to emphasize, we always tend to look at the top solutions. I just did it for you. If you don't, I did it. However, there is no such thing as a small solution because it's a system that caused the problem. It's the system that needs to change. It's everything, everything. So there's nothing small. Everything is important. And even solutions that aren't here are important. And people ask me, you know, what's the call to action? The call to action is to get turned on about something. That's the call to action. I don't know what you should do. I have no idea. If I told you what you should do, you should run. I don't know who you know? So this call to action thing, you should. Okay, go ahead if you want to should. But the point being is, if you look at this book and you look at these solutions, one of them, I hope, at least will say, wow. I know this, or I want to know about this, or this appeals to me. I want to spend my life outside working, or whatever it is, you know, and that is what you can do really, really well. And that's where you'll gain experience and enjoy the book. Why did we call it this? A Stanford intern sent the most comprehensive plan ever proposed to reverse global warming as the verso for the back of the book. My editor sent it to me last summer, and I said, no. It is not a plan. And who wrote this? And I left it on my desk, and I kept looking at it every day. And the more I looked at it, the more I thought this person is right. And this is why. It is the most comprehensive plan ever proposed to reverse global warming because no one ever proposed one. So we got that one. Sorry. All right. You can put any adjective you want, most literate, most funny, it's not very funny, but most anything, because it'll be true, right? Plan is the one that really stopped me, and I realized we weren't making a plan. That sounds like we know what to do. And again, what I said is, we think humanity has a plan. Collectively, we have a plan. And we keep looking, with all due respect, for love in all the wrong places. Some charismatic white male vertebrate is gonna know what to do and tell us. Well, a charismatic white male vertebrates have got us into this shithole, so I don't think we should we should count on that as being a way out, you know? And it's our collectivity, it's not saying anything against white males, I happen to know one. What I'm saying is it's us, and us means connected in a way that we aren't connected, and not about fear. You know, got the news, thank you for sharing. Shut up now, we're working on the solution, right? I mean, it's the only thing that makes sense. I talk about language. We have to change how we talk to each other about this. The way we're talking about it is crazy. It's crazy. We're saying fight climate change. Really? Go for it. You and Don Quixote, I mean, it's like climate is supposed to change, is what it does. It's brilliant. It doesn't care what we think, by the way. The atmosphere changes every nanosecond and always will. So this idea that we should combat it, that it's a crusade, that we should fight it, is so dualistic. Essentially what we're saying is the climate is our enemy, and we've got to fix it and fight it. That's the thinking that got us into the situation, the thinking that the ocean was other, that there's other races, that there's other people, other genetics, other cultures, other... That's otherness of the world is the same thinking that got us into this problem. And it's not going to get us out. If we talk that way, basically, we are righteous, we're making other people wrong. Oh, that's not, I mean, how is that working for us? I mean, it's not working. When you move towards possibility, you're not making somebody wrong. People don't want to be made wrong. I'm sorry, in the last election cycle, I don't care who is running, should have said to the coal miners, thank you, you, your families, your forebears, your grandmothers and grandfathers who sacrificed their lives and health and lived in pretty bad environments in terms of water quality and this and education for lighting up and powering this nation. And we're going to do everything we can to support you educationally, economically, and your children and your children's children to make a transition. That's what we're here to do. And we didn't. We demonized them. Come on. And somebody didn't, and look who's president. I mean, it's the way we talk to each other has to change about this issue. Slash emissions, as if we had machetes. The carbon war room, as if war, if carbon was the enemy. Carbon's our ally. It's absolutely our ally. And then these terms, negative emissions. Do you know what negative emissions means? I mean, in parlance, in climate parlance, it means sequestering carbon. It means positive. But what's a negative emission? What's a negative tree? We can use, what's a negative suit coat? It's nothing. It doesn't exist. And yet this is the language that's being used by the climate establishment. And the climate establishment exists. It's not a bad thing, it's a human thing. Establishments come together whenever human beings coalesce around anything. There's a bad mitten establishment, really. It's in Indonesia, it's also corrupt. As many establishments are, I'm not saying the climate one is, it is not, but it's breathing its own exhaust, that's for sure, and talking to each other. And what is it saying? What does the climate establishment say to you? 2 Celsius, 2 Celsius, 2 Celsius, 2 C, 2 C, 2 C. If we go beyond that, then we're in terra incognita or terra nova, we don't know what will happen, we may never be able to come back. You know, in positive feedback loops, the permafrost, etc. You know, warning. 2C came from Johann Schellenhuber in 1994 in Germany because the German government was saying, all these papers are confusing us. He said, just think 2C. He pulled it out of thin air. It is not a science-based target. It's not. I'm not saying it's not true. It could be. It could be less than that. Who knows? But the point is, what does 2C mean to 99.9999% of the people in the world? Nothing. Americans don't even know what it means in Fahrenheit. Here you are, you're poor, your children just got their uniforms on, you barely afford to get them the uniform so they can go to school, and you wake up in the morning and it's 2C. Huh? Nothing. Means nothing. What is 2C? So, again, you know, we have biologists and neuroscientists and psychologists saying the human brain is not wired to deal with future existential threat. It's not how we evolved. Nothing wrong with that. It just happens to be true. And so what does the climate establishment do? Wave to Sierra, which is a future existential threat, and wonders why it isn't working. It will never work. What will work? It's like there's this house in the humanity's home, and we're going in the back door, and it's padlocked shut. That's 2C and future existential threat. Let's go in the front door. What's in the front door? Human need. Humans who have needs. What do humans need? Living wage, dignified jobs that make a difference in the world, that give them respect, respect from their children and their community, and that give them a sense of purpose in the world. And we are the only species on Earth without full employment. Only one. And never has there been so much good work needed to be done. Never. And we can't figure out a way to come together and work this out. 98 of the 100 solutions in Drawdown are regenerative development. Regenerative development solutions. Regenerative development is the opposite of degenerative development. What is degenerative development? Pretty much everything you see on Route 7, okay? With all due respect, I hope the car dealers aren't here tonight. But degenerative development is stealing the future and selling in the present and calling it GDP. And regenerative development is healing the future and selling it in the present and calling it GDP. We can do either, except the second one can employ everyone on Earth. So if we want to reverse global warming, our motto should be, let there be jobs. Not just any job, but this job of restoring, of reimagining, of regenerating what it means to be a human being on Earth at this time. This scientist is one of my favorite. I quote him a lot. This might be a spoiler alert, so he came back. If for those who don't know what this means, it's from the movie The Martian, Andy Weir's book. But remember at the end, he comes into a classroom, he's the Amanos Gris, he's the astronaut who came back, really, and there's wannabe astronauts in the room, and there he is, the big hero, and he then talks to them pretty candidly, and he says, you know, like, listen up, pay attention, you know, because this is going to happen to you and this is going to save your life. When I was up there, did I think I was going to die? Absolutely. Absolutely. He said, space does not cooperate. Okay, put in atmosphere or climate. Doesn't cooperate at all. Right? So it's at some point, every one of you, he said, is going, everyone who goes up there is going to go south on you. And you're going to say, this is how I end, right? And he said, now you can either accept that or you can go to work. And then he said, you do the math. Oh, love that part. You do the math. You solve one problem, and you solve another problem, and if you solve enough problems, you get to come home. It's just what Paul said. This is reversing global warming is about coming home, and you have to ask yourself a really important prepositional question, which is this: is global warming happening to you or for you? It's just a preposition, after all. Because if it's two, then what are you? You're the object, you're the victim, short end of the stick, born the wrong time, blame others, sue Exxon, demonize those who deny the science. How much fun is that? Not much. But if you imagine that it's happening for you, that it's a gift, that it's an offering, that it's a generous offering. And why is that so? Because any system that does not respond to feedback perishes. And this is simply feedback from the atmosphere. It's just feedback. So if you imagine it's happening for you, then basically you can take 100% responsibility. That's done. I drive, I flew, I had meat one day. I mean, you take 100% responsibility, and now you can focus on the solution, on imagination, on reinventing what it means to be here at this time on Earth with each other, so forth. And it is a very different life that you will lead, and it's a very different outcome that it will create. Thank you very much for being here tonight. I just want to acknowledge all of you and this state for being, I mean, I wish you could have elected the president as well, but you do a lot for the environment. To pull a chit, really, is my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather's Ethan Allen. So, I don't know. So, I know what it's like to be feisty and to get in trouble, and Vermonters do it so well, and I just want to acknowledge you for that. Thank you so much. He's here to tell you that I'm here to take questions. There's a microphone there, and there's a microphone there. So people can hear your question. I should have told you that before, but I didn't. Want to see a movie? Want to see a 2-minute film while we're waiting? Okay, let me tell you the story. I need sound on this one, a lot of sound. Okay. This is a story, this is a true story. You know Ray Anderson, the founder of Interface, and who is really the leading CEO in the world in terms of sustainability, the head of the President's Council for Sustainable Development. Just an amazing man. He died 5 years ago, and 3 years ago, the board of directors of Interface chose a new CEO. And we have there's a green team at Interface. Janine Benyus is one of them. I'm one of them. John Picard, Bill Browning, and we were invited to come in because they wanted to name a new 20-year goal. Their 20-year goal, established in 2000, was net zero emissions, net zero carbon, net zero waste. And they're 91% there. So we need a new goal. I don't think people really understand Interface's, what they've done, extraordinary. And then people said, but the new CEO, he's been chosen, he's a climate denier, he's a Republican, he supports Donald Trump. And we're going, we're not going. You know, it's like, no. Then he was told about the meeting and he said, why am I meeting these greenies? I got a job to do. And we both felt the same way, but we both came together. His name is Jay. He's a really, really nice guy, superb guy, actually. And we met in Serenby, outside of Atlanta, and we went around the room like you do at a small room, and everybody said, I am so-and-so, and this is what I'm doing, and blah, 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 you know, introducing ourselves. And Janine did that, and then John did that, who's in Silicon Valley, and then Bill Browning did it with biophilia, Janine did with biomimicry, then I came in at the end with drawdown, and he was stunned, just stunned at not just what we were doing, but who we knew. the heads of government, the CEOs, the institutions, and so he was like, wow, these people are really connected. And he went to bed that night, and he came up the next morning and said, announced that the 20-year goal of interface would be to reverse global warming. And we were just like, huh? Like, I've never seen a road to Damascus experience in real time. You hear about them, but there it was. I mean, he changed. So, why do I want to show you this? He made this. He chose the music. These are his words. And what it starts off with is Ray Anderson, but it starts off showing this carpet is made from fishing nets that Interface buys from children who get them off the reefs in the Philippines because they're catching ghost fish, you know, basically killing fish. And they take those fishing nets and they make them into carpets. Those are all the carpets you see in the first part. So this is the video that he made. You turn up higher, the music is awesome. Don't tell Bono.
Right in the corner where you are.
Ray Anderson.
Wherever you live, in your daily life.
And these are the carpets.
And my God, what if everybody did it?
Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you now? You got someone to blame.
What's so interesting about Jay is that he texts me now and he said, like, where did Scott Pruitt come from? Did he just fall off a turnip truck? And 2 months ago in London, Interface, they make carpet tiles, you know, the 19-inch square tiles. They measured the carbon emission from producing one tile, it was 7 pounds. And they showed a carpet tile in London that sequesters 2 pounds, total production, 2 pounds of carbon. So they're already there. in this meeting in Serenbe was two years ago. So it's happened fast. Anyway, yes, sir.
Thank you for your inspirational presentation. I was thinking about a question, and what I would like to know is, so you have all these strategies to reduce carbon. What would you say are the top priorities to changing the will of the people where we are today? Would you focus on financial investments for corporations? Would you focus on changing the mindset of other people? Or would you consider changing the capacity of government, God forbid? Which one do you think would be the most impactful today to enact some of those solutions?
Let me ask you a question. Why do you use the word or?
Good question. I will, I know that they are all crucial to doing this, but I think as far as prioritizing where people may put their efforts in the current state, what you think would be the most effective?
You know, it's a great question, by the way. I wasn't trying to take away from that. But my statement would be who, what, where, when, and you know, what government, what level, which country, which people, which culture, which situation, low-lying Pacific vulnerable nation, you know, island nation, or Germany. And then the question is all of the above, and it's all above where you're the most effective and, less, I say, lit up. That's what you want to do. It's, you can't do anything about whether it is the Beltway, probably, because you're not rich and a lobbyist and you don't own a big corporation, I'm guessing.
You got me.
And even if you do, the president isn't listening to big corporations on DACA and that stuff anyway, so that might not work. So again, is to find that place where you're effective. And again, effective means that you want to wake up and do that. It's not like because you think, okay, well, this is the most important thing I do, I'm going to do it, you know. No, don't do that. If I said it anyway, you know. And that's how this thing is going to be solved. I mean, when we are kids, which sandbox do we want to play in? The one where they're hitting each other or the ones where they're laughing? I mean, so the world's going to go to possibility, to joy, to celebration, to creativity, to inclusion, to kindness. It's you know, I know you say, well, it's not. It's going to, you know, they won't replace us marches in Charlottesville. No, it's not. That's the media telling us that. It's not really true. That's not who we are as human beings. And it's really about drawing out, to me, you know, our humaneness, you know, in, again, wherever we are. And it also depends on the video you saw. It came about because we all listened to each other. We listened intently, kindly, respectfully. And that's the only space in which our minds can change. You know, as somebody recently said, I mean, we're trying to change other people's minds. How hard is it to change your own mind? It's really hard. So who in the heck do we think we are that we're going to go change somebody else's minds? But we can change a person by being the person they want to talk to. And they feel like they're being received, you know. And that's what's missing in the climate dialogue to me. We have, like I say, two of these and one of those. It tells you the ratio. You know, I broke it badly tonight. But the point being is this is our most powerful tool, not our tongue, it's our ears. Thank you.
Great, yeah, thank you.
Yes, sir.
I too want to thank you for your words. We need messages of hope in these days, and you've been hopeful, and I appreciate that. As you know, Vermont is an extraordinary place. We have been environmental leaders for my entire life, and we still are. We have some extraordinary goals. We were the first state in the country to have a 90% renewables by 2050. And I'm proud of that, and I think we're making great strides. However, there's one issue that divides us. It divides, you know, good people, environmentalists. It's your number two measure here to reduce global warming.
Yeah, ridgetop turbines, I know. Yeah, so it's onshore. What's your question?
So my question to you is, how do you think that we can overcome that? It's stymied us. It's divided. It's divided good people, and it's created a stalemate amongst our government. Do you have any suggestions on how we get over that controversy?
It's such an interesting controversy, by the way. I find it fascinating. I know where I would go on it. I'm not going to tell you. Because I'm not a Vermonter, and it's, you know, but first of all, you're gonna have to figure it out yourselves because it's your state. Second, what I said about when we were doing work during the time when basically the clear cutting the Northwest and it was just rampant clear cutting, we would go into communities and where they were so divided. I mean, where they were hanging spotted owls in effigy in the back of a truck, you know, with their guns, and you know, the greenies. I mean, it would sit on two sides of the room, and they, you know, it was so polarized. And we did an exercise, basically, which is like, you know, what do you want this county or this place? Usually, it was rural areas, you know, and what do you want it to look like and be like in 2050? Do you want your children to have good paying jobs, you want to be gone into the city? You want more fish in the rivers or less fish? You want more clean? And we get to the point of agreement, and then very, because they all wanted the same thing. They all wanted exactly the same thing if you went out far enough. And then we would very carefully move backwards from that point in time to see, okay, what would we have to do? What would we have to do? What would we have to do? And so forth, instead of forecasting from the present, which can almost invariably lead to divisiveness. And so it's called backcasting, but if done skillfully, and again, people then can listen, maybe even to themselves, to their convictions, or to, it doesn't, you're not asking anybody to give up their convictions, their science, their knowledge, their, you know, that's not the ask. The ask is, can we figure out together how to get to where we all want to go together and stay together? And as soon as we get to that point where we divide, they're right there. But it's so much more effective at that point working backwards than it is from where you are right now, which is, you know, pretty polarized and logical too, by the way. There's just impeccable logic on both sides. It's not like one's emotional and one's rational. It's not true. They're both rational, you know, the sides. And so that's the only way I know how to do that. I wish you all really the best in this. And I wish I had some magic solution. I don't. Anyway, thank you so much. One more question. And
I'll give you another chance at magic.
And okay.
It's the market. Many of the opportunities you lay out there suggest that there are some real economic gains to be had by pursuing them.
Yes.
And yet, currently, we're not putting in the level of effort necessary to capture those gains. So, what's missing?
I don't know. I mean, time. You know, things move slowly. The net operating profit from the 80 solutions we modeled in 2050 is $73.4 trillion. So the money's there. Capital formation, capital movement, capital is the most conservative thing there is. It's very conservative en masse. We have $500 billion right now of funds talking to us about doing a drawdown fund, a drawdown index, a risk assessment, you know, based on drawdown. So this is a half a trillion dollars, which is starting to be real money in this world. It sounds funny to say that, but actually it used to be, and now it's not as much as it used to be, but there's $80 trillion moving around in capital markets, or maybe more, counting derivatives. But what I see is a lack of communication. What we're seeing is there's more money wanting to go in this direction. Family funds are shifting from one generation to the next. The next generation is not interested in financing the past and wants to finance the future. And the future is clear to them, and I think to all of you. And yet they're having trouble finding places to put the money. And so that goes back to what Joe's saying about entrepreneurship and value creation. You can do it as an NGO as well, such as Ecotrust is doing it in Portland and buying forest lands and basically, you know, restoring them. And it can be done by both for and nonprofits, but it takes good work and hard work. But I do feel that the capital is at the ready. That's what I sense from that. Anyway, listen, thank you so much for coming tonight, and have a great conference.